Good to see everyone here today. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. You know what I heard? I heard in the news this week that people have more fun than anybody. Let's have a good time at church today. Amen. I'll fly away.
Some glad morning when this life is o'er, I'll fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I'll fly away. I'll fly away, oh glory. I'll fly away. When I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away. When the shadows of this life have gone, I'll fly away. Like a bird from prison bars has flown, I'll fly away.
Woman in the Bible days, her last meal almost gone. God sent Elijah to make his word known. He said, woman, don't you worry, for God sent me today. And before you even asked him, help is on the way. Coming for those who believe and pray. Help won't help tomorrow if you give up today. Just hold on a little longer. Help is on the way. Troubles of this life come by and burdens get you down. You think no one is listening, you think no one's around. Just remember what his word says, trust him and obey. And keep your eyes toward the heavens, yeah, the help is on the way. Just hold on a little longer, help is on the way. A brighter day is coming for those who believe and pray. Help won't help tomorrow if you give up today. Just hold on a little longer, help is on the way.
In his love abiding, I shall not be moved. And in him confiding, I shall not be moved. Just like a tree that's planted by the water, I shall not be moved. I shall not be, I shall not be moved, just like a tree that's planted by the water. I shall not be moved. Though I held a sail me, I shall not be moved. Jesus will not fail me, I shall not be moved, just like a tree that's planted by the water. I shall not be moved. Tempest rages, I shall not be moved. On the rock of ages, I shall not be moved. Just like a tree that's planted by the water, I shall not be moved. I shall not be, I shall not be moved.
I shall not be moved.
I shall not be, I shall not be moved. Just like a tree that's planted by the water, I shall not be moved. Just like a tree that's planted by the water, I shall not be moved.
Hey.
There's within my heart a melody. Whisper sweet and low. Fear not, I am with thee. Peace be still in all of thy ebb and flow. Jesus, 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 sweetest name I know. Fills my every longing, keeps me singing as I
Amen.
You have your Bibles with you this morning. If you would open them up to Matthew chapter number 8. Chapter number 8 in the book of Matthew. Man, I feel like I'm a nervous wreck this morning after being off one Sunday, you know. That's what it feels like to be backslid, I guess. All right, Matthew chapter number 8. Chapter number 8, let's look at verse number 5. And when Jesus was entered into Capernaum, there came unto him a centurion, beseeching him, and saying, Lord, my servant lieth at home sick of the palsy, grievously tormented. And Jesus saith unto him, I'll come and heal him. The centurion answered and said, Lord, I'm not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my servant shall be healed. For I'm a man under authority, having soldiers under me, and I say to this man, go, and he goeth, and to another, come, and he cometh. And to my servant, do this, and he doeth it. When Jesus heard it, he marveled, and said unto them that followed, Verily I say unto you, I have not found so great faith, no, not in Israel. Let's bow our hearts and pray this morning. Heavenly Father, thank you, Lord, for this day you've given to us. And Father, I thank you. Thank you, Lord, for your Holy Spirit. Thank you, Lord, for everybody who's here this morning. And God, I pray that today we would learn something from the Word of God. I pray that we'd learn a truth, Lord, that would stay with us. I pray, Holy Spirit, that you would teach us today. Bless all who are here. If there's one in our midst today that does not know Jesus, I pray that they would be saved in this hour. And I pray for Christians, Lord, here today that need a touch from heaven, that we would all receive that touch from you. In Jesus' name we pray, and everyone said, amen. I have some things I want to say this morning and talk to you about. And it's not my intention to upset somebody, but if you get upset, I guess you're just upset. But I'm going to say them anyway, because I feel like that's what the Lord would have me to say. And I just, you know, here recently, Brother Ray and I have been talking, and it seems like the topic of the simplicity of the gospel has just been brought up so many times. Ladies and gentlemen, the gospel is simple. It is simple gospel, simply grace. It truly is. And there's so much junk that's going on outside these doors today and that brings so much confusion to the body of Christ. And man, I tell you, if you're not careful, you can find yourself getting caught up in things that you really don't want to be caught up in them. And if you really take a good logical look at things, you'd say, that was silly. I mean, that's my opinion. And so I just want to address some things today. I want to talk to you about faith today. Faith. You know, me and late night TV, we seem to have an affair going on. That's all I can say. I've mentioned to you many times before that I wake up in the middle of the night and I have this irresistible urge to turn on Christian television. I wish I could just go back to sleep. But maybe I'm waking up to watch this stuff so it will give me sermon topics to share with you. I don't know, like today. But I woke up one morning this week, it was in the middle of the night, and I turned on the TV, and there was a lady on there. Man, she was just preaching away. Just preaching away. Barn burning preaching. The problem is, it had nothing to do with Jesus. His name wasn't even mentioned that I recall. But what it was about planting your financial seed of faith. Your financial seed of faith. Faith was her topic, and she gave several examples of how God has answered prayers through her faith. But her faith was about the size of her faith because she and her husband were planting seeds of faith. She even made it more personal by telling how she ordered her husband that we need to go to the bank and we're going to clean out all of our accounts and we're going to send all of that money as seed money to some ministry. Well, planting their financial seed of faith, according to her, increased their faith to the point that after they were diagnosed with having infertility, they suddenly became pregnant not once but twice. So I say, well, God bless them for wanting to have children and that God gave them children because that was their desire. But Her point was the miraculous happened because of the faith that she had in planting a financial seed. There was nothing in her sermon about the death and the burial and the resurrection of Jesus. And by the way, that's the only way people get saved. Amen. It was about you and me sending our hard-earned cash to their ministry so that they can be on television. And here's some of the notes that run across the little ticker screen. These are the things that they say to you subconsciously to help you make these decisions. Number one, when you release the seed in your hand, God will release the harvest in His hands. Now, next one says, release God's abundance. Well, let me tell you, folks, God released His abundance when He gave us Jesus. Amen. And the next one says, break the spirit of debt. Sow your $1,000 seed now. So let me just give you a little piece of advice. If you have $1,000 today in cash, apply that to your debt.
Amen.
Amen? The next one is, activate your faith. You did when you accepted Jesus as your Savior. Amen. The next one says, your seed has power to release God's harvest. You know what? God's power is not dependent on me releasing anything. Amen. Those are some things to just keep in mind the next time you see something like this going on. Now listen to me. I'm your pastor and I love you. And I'm telling you not to get caught up in junk like this, because here's two good reasons. Number one, you'll wind up broke. You'll wind up financially broke. And number two, when your seed doesn't grow, you'll be broken spiritually.
Yeah.
Yes. Amen? Think about these things now, folks. Now, you might be thinking, now, Brother Tim, you're just against me growing my faith. Well, no, I'm actually not against you growing your faith. I'm all for growing your faith, but I'm saying let's be logical in our thinking and trusting in what God has already provided you and I. Now, that's a very important statement. We need to trust in what God has already provided for you and I. Amen? Do I believe in having faith? Absolutely I do. I truly do, ladies and gentlemen. Now, you can hear Christians make statements like this oftentimes. They'll say, and I've been guilty of this, perhaps you are too, I don't know, I'm not picking on anybody, but here are statements that Christians make. I need more faith. I need more faith. You need more faith. If you had more faith, you would be healed. If you had more faith, God would do miracles. If we had more faith, we could do this and we could do that. Now, do you see the assumption that's being made here? The assumption is this. You don't have enough faith. That's the assumption. Amen? Now, do you know that even Jesus' disciples and apostles, they had the same thoughts? In Luke 17, 5, they said, Lord, increase our faith. The apostles' view was pretty much like the modern-day view of the church. They thought that faith comes in increments. But if that's our viewpoint, then we'll continue to think all the time, I need more faith, I need more faith, I need more faith. Dear loved one, that's not a true statement. Faith is not given to us by degrees. Faith is given to you in the person of Jesus Christ. And let me just say this, it is Jesus who is our faith.
Amen.
Jesus Christ is my faith. People say, what faith are you? Jesus. Think about that for just a minute. Jesus is our faith. So what is faith? Well, the Bible gives us a good definition in Hebrews 11, 1. It says, faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. But there are many people who have their own idea of what faith is. Some people say, well, if faith is a warm, tingly feeling that you get when you're being spiritually moved. Others say that it's a degree of confidence or a lack of fear. Let me tell you something. Here's a warning for you. Faith is not a feeling. Faith cannot be a feeling. Faith has never been a feeling. Amen? Talking about faith today. A person expressing faith can feel confident or spiritually moved, but they have to realize that our faith is not grounded in our feelings. Why is that? How many people feel like you did yesterday or the day before? How many people are just overjoyed right now with feelings? How many of you are sad? How many of you are mediocre? How many of you just don't care? Amen? My point is this. Feelings change, don't they? If our faith was based on feelings, our faith would be up and down and everywhere in the middle, front and back and on the sides. Amen. Biblical faith is this. Biblical faith is objective, meaning that it's not influenced by personal feelings or opinions. Biblical faith is based on more than your influence or your personal feelings. Faith is an actual reality, and it has a concrete source. Now, that is another important statement. Faith is an actual reality, and it has a concrete source. I've heard it said that the strength of faith is in the object of one's faith. That's a true statement. That strength of faith is in the object of one's faith. So let me ask you this. Can faith in a golden calf do you any good? What if you put your faith in a human religious leader? Will that help you? It would make no difference how much faith you have if you place it in an unreliable source. Amen? You know, I think swallowing is good. How many people like to swallow? Swallowing is good, isn't it? Amen? Unless you've got a jaw full of tobacco and then you swallow, that's not going to be good. But you know what? Swallowing is good and it makes you live. How many people would agree with that? But did you know that if you swallow poison, it's going to cause you to die? It isn't swallowing that makes you live. It's what you swallow. It's the object that determines the result. Faith is the same way. Having a mountain-sized faith in the wrong object will do you no good. Amen? Oh, I got mountain faith. If it's in the wrong place, it's not going to help you. Do you see that it's not about how much faith you have? But the better question is this: who have you put your faith in? That was my third most important point. So if you're keeping up, there you go. The object of our faith is not the only important thing. We have to also realize the importance of the source of our faith. Faith is not worked up by positive words or thoughts. Amen? Anybody can go around and have all kinds of positive things to say, and I think we ought to think positive. I really do, but that's not going to increase our faith. Our faith is realized in Jesus Christ and in Jesus Christ alone. Our faith is realized in Jesus Christ and in Jesus Christ alone. He doesn't just give us faith, ladies and gentlemen. He does not just give us faith, but He is our faith. Now listen to this. We live by His life, meaning we are living by divine faith. I'm living by the life of Jesus Christ, which means He's my faith. I'm living in His divine faith. I'm going to tell you, you're looking at me kind of confused, and I'll have to tell you, I went through a period of that too while I was preparing this message. It's kind of like scrambled eggs, but if you follow me and stay with me, maybe it'll develop after a while. But we live by His life, meaning we are living by divine faith. The old song from yesteryear says this: I care not today what tomorrow may bring, if shadow or sunshine or rain. The Lord I know ruleth o'er everything, and all of my worries are vain. Help me out. Living by faith in Jesus above, trusting, confiding in His great love. From all harm safe in His sheltering arms, I'm living by faith and I feel no alarm. Now, I think the songwriter had it right when he says, I'm living by faith in Jesus above. It is the resurrected life of Jesus being lived in and out and through us that is our faith and nothing else, dear friend. Amen? Did you know that our faith is produced from the work of the Father? Our faith is produced from the work of the Father. There's no power that can produce faith. Did that statement make any sense to you? There's no power that can increase faith. I don't have my wallet on me. Who's got a wallet? Give me some money and I'll increase your faith. You're laughing at me. I don't think you believe it. Amen? There's no power that will increase our faith. This faith only comes from our Heavenly Father. When we become born again, it is the result of grace through faith. faith in the finished work of the Father through His beloved Son. Amen? Ephesians 2, 8 and 9 says this, a very familiar passage. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Grace is the cause of our salvation, and faith is the way that we experience it. Did you notice that when it comes to faith, it doesn't come from us? It doesn't come from us. It is the gift that the Father gives to us. He gives us faith that we possess as a gift. Amen. Thank you, God, for that gift of faith. Without faith, we couldn't be saved. Amen. I have faith in what God did through His Son on the cross of Calvary. Amen. Therefore, I am a born-again believer. I am saved. I'm eternally secure in Jesus and His finished work. And it's by the faith that God gave me to trust His grace. Amen. Amen? Yes. Glory to God. He gives us faith that we possess as a gift. We don't get faith by having our minds right. Anybody in here got a right mind? I'm out of mind, let me tell you. We don't get faith by having our minds right. We don't get faith by attacking the cookie jar that's filled with $10 bills to send to the TV evangelist either. We don't get faith even by fasting. We don't get faith even by fasting. We receive faith through Jesus, and then we live by His faith, not a faith that we try to produce. Amen? Does that make sense to you today? Now listen, most TV evangelists are not going to like me telling you these things, but I want you to understand I'm trying to lead today as the under-shepherd in this body of Christ. Amen? And I will go on to say this. There are plenty of very worthy ministries to contribute to financially if you wish to do that on television and in the radio media. But I want you to be careful as to who's preaching Jesus and who's declaring to you that you need to break your bank account so that they can use your seed money in their gardens of personal harvest. Amen? Yeah. Amen? Now, I know I pick on these guys a lot, but I guess it's probably because they're the most visible. But listen, I know of Christians in churches and possibly in our church here today that they'll go on, well, I guess I just need a little more faith. Pastor Tim, if I just had faith, and I tell you, I've been praying a lot here lately that I'll just have more faith. Now listen to what Paul wrote in Galatians 2:20. It's a very famous passage. Paul said this, I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live. Yet not I, but Christ liveth in me, and the life that which I now live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God. By the faith of the Son of God. By the faith of the Son of God, who loved me and gave Himself for me. Now, there's a lot of translations, a lot of Bible translations that they substitute here by with the word in. It says, I live by faith in the Son of God. I don't guess there's really anything wrong with that. Amen? Robert Young lived and died in the 1800s. He was a Scottish publisher who was self-taught and proficient in several ancient languages. He wrote Young's literal translation of the Bible. It's an extremely literal translation that attempts to preserve the tense and word usage as found in the original Greek and Hebrew writings. They say that it's very likely that it is the most strictly literal English translation ever developed. So regarding Galatians 2:20 and Young's literal translation, it says it like this, with Christ I have been crucified, and live no more do I. And Christ doth live in me, and that which I now live in the flesh, in the faith I live of the Son of God, who did love me and give Himself for me. That sounds very close to the King James Version, amen? But there's an emphasis here I want to point out that I think will offer a clearer understanding of what Paul's saying. It's true that we do live by faith in the Son of God, but to complete this picture even better, we live by the faith of the Son of God. Think about the faith that Jesus has, amen, when he was on this earth. We are in Christ. He is in us. We have the faith of the Son of God. There's a difference there, amen? As Paul was addressing the Galatians, he reminded them that they were freed from the law. And so he said in Galatians 3:23, but before faith came, But before faith came, we were kept under the law. We were shut up unto the faith, which should afterward be revealed. So Israel was under the law before Jesus' resurrection. Amen? Israel only had prophecies of the Messiah coming, of the way, the truth, and the life. But while under the law, they were shut up of the faith that would later be revealed. So what was eventually revealed? Jesus Christ, the Son of God, was revealed. Grace through faith. Amen? Paul is not talking just about belief. He's talking about Jesus, who is our faith. There's a lot of different types of faith. The topic of faith, though, has been abused, in my opinion. There's a lot of scriptures that point to various kinds, such as there is the measure of faith, there's great faith, there's growing faith, there's unwavering faith, and so on and so forth. And there's plenty of scriptures to tag on to all of these to make them viable. But what I hope that we'll understand here today is there is but just one faith, and that is the faith that is found only in Jesus, who is our faith. I'm really going somewhere with this, okay? I hope you hold on, okay? Jesus is our faith. One of my favorite songs is sung by Miss Patty oftentimes. It's called Beulah Land by Squire Parsons. And the second verse of that song says this, I'm looking now just across the river to where my faith shall end in sight. There's just a few more days to labor, then I will take my heavenly flight. That phrase that says, to where my faith shall end in sight. I like to think of that not so much of actually seeing heaven, although that's going to be wonderful, but seeing Jesus, whom I do not see now, but my faith will turn to sight. Amen? Hebrews 11:1. Now faith is the substance of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen, ladies and gentlemen. You know, I think it's a little absurd to say that I need more faith. Now you're looking at me like, what do you mean? Well, I would caution you this morning to stop saying that you need more faith, and here's why. That kind of thinking is going to cause you to constantly evaluate yourself and wondering if you have enough faith. And every time that you go down this road, you're going to come to the awful conclusion of, I don't have enough faith. I don't have enough faith. The faith that the believer has, whether you realize it or not, you have all the faith that you'll ever have and that you'll ever need. And you know why that is? That's because Jesus is our faith. Jesus is our faith. You cannot get more of Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
I mean, I've been preaching here for 7 years. I thought I'd get an amen on that. We've been saying that a lot. You cannot get more of Jesus. Amen. Now, if you cannot get more of Jesus and Jesus is our faith, where does that leave me with wanting to get more faith? I cannot get more faith than what Jesus has, and Jesus is my faith. I cannot get more faith. Boy, I tell you, TV evangelists are loving me if they tune this one in. They'll probably use me on the program, amen? And I want you to know that Jesus is my faith, amen? You and I this morning, we're operating in the faith of Jesus. He's our faith. Faith moves mountains, right? How many of you have had a mountain moved out of the way because God did the miraculous? Amen? Well, you know, we call that living by faith. So what is that? It is having Jesus Christ. It is His faith that has moved the mountains. Amen? So what am I saying? When we look only to Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as our only hope, then we see Him as our source of faith. Amen? If we take our eyes off of what we do, such as in praying to have more faith and fasting for more faith or giving money for more faith, then I'm taking the right approach then. Jesus, if Jesus is my faith, then all I ever will need is Him. Because He says, I'm complete in Him. There's the key. That's the key to the sermon today. Do you want more faith? Then you need to get saved. If you're saved, you have all the faith that you'll ever need because you're complete in Jesus. And He said that. Amen. The Bible says in 2 Peter 3:18, I believe, we are to grow in grace and in the knowledge of Jesus. Grow in grace and in the knowledge.
If we start growing in our knowledge of Him,
yeah.
Mary, if we start growing more in our knowledge about Jesus, learning about Him, oh my goodness, we're going to learn that I've got faith. You know why I have faith, Rick? Because Jesus is my faith. Amen? And buddy, I cannot increase Jesus.
Amen.
You cannot increase Jesus Christ. So listen, don't focus your faith. Don't focus on your faith. Now I want to read something to you that came to me in a text message this morning. It's a little devotion. And I was just so put out over this. And I just have to share it with you. Because listen, I just made a statement. Don't focus on your faith. Matthew 11:29 says this, "Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls." Do you like that? You shall find rest unto your souls. Here's the quote that came to me this morning regarding Matthew 11:29. The question is this, please tell me, I'm quoting, please tell me how many people are going to make it to heaven when His church buildings are being ignored on the Lord's day. Let me just tell you something, ladies and gentlemen, unquote. There's no grace found in that statement. If it was about me being faithful in the house of God before I could get to heaven, brother, I'm going to hell in a minute.
Yeah.
Amen? That's a works-based religion.
Yes.
That's a works-based thought. It is not about Jesus at all. It's about my faith,
yes.
My work, my doings. And Jesus is saying, for by grace are you saved through faith. Amen? What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Amen? I'll just make this one up. What can make me born again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is that flow. Amen. Glory to God. Now, folks, I'm not trying to pick on people, but I said, let's be logical this morning. Amen. I think that's how I opened this up today. We need to be logical in our thinking, logical in our Christian thinking, logical in our faith thinking, logical in our grace thinking, logical in Jesus. Amen? Amen. You don't need more faith. Let's go back to Matthew 11:28-30. It says, "Come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I'll give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I'm meek and lowly in heart, and you shall find rest unto your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light." I like how Eugene Peterson writes it out in his version of the Message. It says this, "Are you tired? Are you worn out? Are you burned out on religion? Come to me. Get away with me and you'll recover your life." If you'll get with Jesus, you'll recover your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. Walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. And I like how this last line is coming up. It's appropriate for what we're talking about today. He finishes up by saying, "Keep company with me and you'll learn to live freely and lightly."
Yes.
Keep company with Jesus. Amen. Keep company with Jesus. Do you see my point? It is what we learn of Jesus. It's what we learn of Him. And I guess the question begs here, how often, you want a little conviction thrown on you? How often are we reading our Bible to learn of Jesus? How often do we listen to a good sermon by good godly men? How often are we engaging in conversations with godly people who like to talk about Jesus? And I'm going to tell you, you might think, oh yeah, we know all about this topic. Then bingo, a word is said or a phrase is mentioned that takes it in left field, buddy. Then you got a whole new study going on. And you know what you just did? You just grew another inch or two, amen?
That's right.
You just grew another inch or two. And it's about what we learn about Jesus, amen? You know what? Thank God. I appreciate you folks. I could go around this room and just go to every one of you name by name and say thank you for your contributions financially to this ministry today. I really appreciate it. But you know what? I'm not going to beg you for your money. I don't have to. You give from the abundance of your heart. That's grace giving. Amen? That's grace giving. What I would rather you do is, we need your contributions if we want to stay in this building. Okay, let's make that plain to you right now. Boy, I started stammering and stuttering there, didn't I? But we do need finances to operate. That's logical thinking. Amen? But I really want us to be growing in grace and knowledge of Jesus. Amen. This is a Jesus ministry. Amen. This is a ministry about lifting up the Son of God. That's what we're about here today. You know, I really don't have a problem by saying our faith will increase the more we learn of Him, because as we learn, we begin to understand things like this. I'm complete in Jesus. And there's no better place that you can ever be in this life by being saved and being complete in Him. All I ever have, I will ever have in Jesus. But I can spend the rest of my life learning of Him. Amen? I have all I will ever need in Him, but I can spend the rest of my life learning of Him. You know, the disciples were on a ship one night, and a storm came up, and the waves began to crash on top of the boat, and they got scared and frightened. They ran down inside the ship, and they woke up Jesus, and they said, "Lord, save us, we perish." And I'd just like to stop here for just a moment and say this. This ought to be the prayer of every lost sinner today. Lord, save me, I perish. And in that statement, what you're saying when you say Lord, you're saying this, that you know He is who He said He is, King of Kings, and He's the Savior, and you're putting your belief in His death, burial, and resurrection when you call Him Lord, when you believe Him as Lord. When you say save me, that is the request of salvation, trusting only what He can do. And when you say we perish, when you're saying Lord, I perish, there is the understanding that without Christ, there is no hope. And the disciples ran to Him and said, Lord, save us. We perish. Now let's get back to our story. Jesus rose up and said, why are you so fearful? Do you have little faith? In other words, why are you so worried? Why are you so concerned? Why are you frightened and why are you scared? Guys, I'm right here. I'm right here. And let me tell you something, fellas. I'm never going to perish. And you're never going to perish. Jesus is our faith. Amen? Why do we worry? Why do we fear? Why do we fret? All I have in Jesus. Because Jesus lives in and through me, I'm whole and I'm complete and I'm full of Him. He's my faith. When we go back to our story about the centurion here, I think he offers one of the best examples of what faith in Jesus really looks like. He had a request. He went to Jesus that he would come and heal his servant. And Jesus said, well, I'll come and heal him. Did you notice that there was no hesitation there? Jesus said, I'll come and do it. The guy says, well, I'm not even worthy for you to come under my roof. But Jesus, if you will just say the word, that'd be enough. And Jesus marveled and said, never in Israel have I ever seen such faith like this. Let me tell you something. That centurion was looking at his faith eye to eye.
Yeah.
He was looking at his faith eye to eye when he looked in the eyes of Jesus. Does that tell us something today? He's my faith. Boy, that takes the load off of my wallet. I don't have to worry about coming up with $1,000 to plant a seed somewhere to get my faith to grow. I don't have to worry about a spirit of debt. There is no such thing. There's a whole lot of no such things out there if you listen carefully. Amen? The centurion was looking at his faith eye to eye. He's seen all the faith he would ever need in Jesus. And you know what? The Bible says the servant was healed. Your faith is not planting financial seeds here or there. Your faith is not in chain letters. Your faith is not in fastings. Your faith is in Jesus. He has all you'll ever need. It was His grace that saved us. It was faith in what He accomplished at Calvary. And in the garden tomb when He arose, oh, that's our faith. Amen? That's our faith. I don't know about you, but I'd rather have my faith in the One who rose from the dead than placing my faith anywhere else. It's the object that I'm putting my faith in The object that I'm looking at today is the Son of God. And He is my faith. I hope you see that today, and I hope you believe it today. Amen. Come on up, musicians. Let's have a song this morning. I would not want you to leave here today unless you had an opportunity to receive the Lord in your heart if you're not saved today. And you know what? It takes faith to trust Him today. Jesus is our faith. He's the grace that we need, amen, to save our souls from hell. Let's bow our hearts today. Heavenly Father, I pray that if there's one in this service here today, Lord, that needs to be saved, I pray that they will look to You this morning, right now, trusting and believing, as the disciples said one night on that boat, Lord, save us, we perish. Recognizing You as Lord means that they believe in Your death, burial, and resurrection, that You are the Son of God. You're the one who came to this earth and gave Your life and shed Your precious blood, that royal blood that sets every soul free that I call upon You today. And God, I'm so glad the Bible says, for whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. God, when those disciples said, save us, they were looking to You as the only one who was able to save and give them courage and in their heart right now to believe, Lord, that You can save them. And Lord, when they admitted that they would perish, Lord, without Jesus, all men will perish. So I pray today, Lord, if there's one in our audience today that needs to know the Lord, they'll say, Lord, save me or I'm going to perish. Jesus, if there's a Christian here today that's been battling and confused about faith, Lord, and wishing that they could grow or get more faith, help them to see You today as all the faith they'll ever need is right in You today. We've been made complete. We're filled up. There's no room for anything else when we're complete. And Your Word says we're complete today. Father, I pray right now that there'll be prayers going on as we celebrate the Lord Jesus Christ today in this song. Would you stand to your feet this morning? Let's sing. Thank You.